Good evening all. Thank you for your nice introduction. Most respected principal of Safi Institute, Professor Imbichi Koyesa, who is the former principal of Farooq College, and for me, he is our beloved and respected manager, Farooq Training College. Then Dr. Shibu, IQAC coordinator, faculty members of Safi Institute, respected teachers who are listening to me in this evening session. Again, good evening, one and all. It is very happy and immense pleasure for me to join with you. Safi Institute, all of us know, an institute with clear-cut vision and mission, established and growing in a different way. Great visionaries are there behind this prestigious institute. That's why I think always Safi Institute organizes different variety of programs. And in this COVID pandemic situation, it is the need of our, it is very important and significant to be here with you in a gathering on the core theme of teacher empowerment. So I'm here in my office, you know, today we have university examination, public examination, just it is completed. That is why I'm here in my office. Okay, I think this is the fifth day of your program. And it's the topic, it's a simple topic. When your IQAC coordinator contacted me, he asked what would be the topic. So the main theme is teacher empowerment. That is why I simply coined this term, the art of teaching. So what is art of teaching? Whether teaching is an art or a science, that is the basic question. So in order to, in one sense, a transmittive way of talk, I would like to become this session purely interactive. That is why no worthy PowerPoint presentation, okay, something like that. But just, I have just prepared, mixed a PowerPoint, not to deviate from this main topic. But that PowerPoint is not major points or content area of my session. My session is fully based on your interaction, your involvement, and just like a discussion. So let me open that PowerPoint. Can you see this slides?
Yes, sir.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
See, I would like to show you two pictures. One is the same, this one, the art of teaching. That is the heading. And you can see this picture. This is picture number one. And the next slide, you will see another picture. It is also very simple. Okay. This is the first picture. And this one is the second picture. Just go through this picture and comment on this picture based on my heading, that is title, The Art of Teaching. I appreciate your active involvement and participation. You can say anything. Please unmute and interact with me.
It's like what is being learned is being taught.
Sorry?
The first picture is about learning, and second picture is about teaching. So it is just like what is being learned is being taught.
Very good. Again, I will show you the picture once more. First picture is learning, you know. Tell me, okay. Okay, this may be learning. And the second one, teaching. Very good comment.
The first picture is about active participation, sir.
Okay, the first picture shows active participation. Both teacher and learner?
Yeah, I'm a teacher, sir.
Okay, then what about the second one?
Second one is the small child, it is just doing what she has seen from others.
Okay.
What the others have done, the child is reenacting that.
Do you mean imitating?
Yeah, imitating.
Okay. So can anybody analyze the second picture from the perspective of a teacher?
Second picture is teaching.
Yeah.
First picture depicts learning, and the second one depicts teaching.
Okay. So from your response, I can see there is a difference between learning and teaching. Am I correct?
Sir.
Yeah.
The first pic in which a teacher is teaching the child, it shows the academic or curriculum-based learning, which okay. is book-oriented or something like that. The second okay. pic in which a child is playing with the doll seems like observational learning, which the child learns from seeing or watching or modeling others.
Hmm. Very good. Anything more?
Excuse me, sir. There are a few messages in the chat box.
Yeah.
The others are interacting through the chat box.
Okay.
Should I read that for you?
Yeah.
First one, Dr. Shiny NK said that the teaching starts from the parents. Yeah. Then Dr. Ibrahim Kuppalath says that teaching through practice. Okay. Saumya says, the art of teaching lies in the expression and application to the fullest.
Okay.
Dr. Hassan Sharif, sir, first one guiding and the second one is spoon feeding.
Okay.
And then Radhika M says, first one teacher-centric approach, the other one learning by doing.
Okay.
And Divya Sharma, in first picture, teacher is teaching, and in second, an environment has been created for learning by self.
Okay.
And again, Dr. Shiny NK, learning and applying what we learn. Again, learning and applying. Learning as well as teaching starts within home by Aisha Jumana Asman.
Hmm.
Learning and practicing. Eric, first picture is learning and second is teaching. Learning okay. through observing. In second, both are not active is a comment by Dr. Ibrahim Kuppalath. And Shafi K, first learn from reality. Deepa Ramachandran, teaching and learning and parenting. Mujib Rahman, first pick shows emotional touching and second pick imitating the learned things. Second is imagination. Second one means teacher is active but learner is passive. First one is guiding and second one is spoon feeding. Yeah, there are a lot of comments. They are interacting through the chat box.
Okay.
Second one is just kid playing and all that.
So thank you. Thank you very much for your sudden and active involvement towards my simple question. You see, it was actually was not an objective based presentation. Just I have collected some pictures. I am using the same picture in multifaceted. Though when I am preparing for this presentation, just picked up these two pictures. Still, this picture has some connection with my title, The Art of Teaching. We can discuss weeks and weeks regarding this picture and the content of this picture, the theory or concept behind this picture. So I have already told you there is a connection between connection with my title and these two pictures. The art of teaching, I mean the way that you are teaching or the meta thinking process about your teaching process. You know, I think the word meta thinking is familiar to you. Can anybody say the real meaning of meta thinking?
Awareness of thinking, sir.
Awareness of thinking, very good. Or another way, simple definition for meta thinking.
Thinking about thinking, sir. Meta cognition.
Yeah, very good. Thinking about thinking process. That is very good. Thinking about thinking. Thinking is a process, you know. Thinking about thinking process. So your meta thinking regarding teaching. That means how you are teaching. You are thinking about how you are teaching. That's the concept. So that is why you told me, you expressed many suggestions, ideas, your reflections, whatever may be. That was seen in the chat box, and some of them expressed in your own voice. So that is the core theme of my topic today. Meta thinking about your teaching or how you are teaching. Have you ever thought of how you are teaching and how you're about thinking about how people are thinking about your teaching? That is the core theme of this presentation. See this statement: when teaching become an art, both learner and teacher enjoy the whole educational process, where teacher becomes an artist. Then go to that pictures, first one, second one. Remember that picture. I will show you again, this one and this one. Then read this statement: when teaching become an art, both learner and teacher enjoy the whole educational process. Educational process, I mean teaching and learning process, where teacher become an artist. You know, artist, whether it is a singer, dancer, something like that. We are listening to the beat of music, enjoying that music, encouraging the singer, and being a participant, you are always enjoying that situation, that performance. So think about your teaching like an art form. Can you become such type of an artist in your classroom? That is my question. So how do you comment upon this statement? See, if I go through my presentation, it will be a stereotype class. That is why I'm asking. When teaching become an art, both learner and teacher enjoy the whole educational process, where teacher becomes an artist. So I will give you more hints. See, can you remember the most inefficient teacher in your student life? Are you ready to go through this exercise? Okay, if it is so, just list out the attributes of that teacher. It's an exercise for you. If you have a simple notepad or something like that, see, just remember the most inefficient teacher in your student life. I'm sure one person will flash up on your mind, no doubt. And just think about that man. maybe from first standard or fifth standard or seventh standard or eighth standard or PG level, maybe in PhD level. Most notorious, I mean. Then list out the attributes of that teacher. Just, I will ask you, what are the things you have listed? Okay. Now you can tell me, what are the attributes?
The pronunciation is not clear.
Sorry, I can't hear you.
Even the pronunciation is not very clear. So even the pronunciation is not very clear in the elder class.
In that class, that teacher.
Yes, sir, the teacher.
Okay. His communication, it is not at all clear, you mean?
Communication gap between the teacher and the student.
Yeah, communication gap between teacher and student. That is why you consider that teacher as most inefficient one. Okay.
Some staff members are memorize and tell the topic to the students.
Staff members are?
Memorize the concept of the particular topic and mug up and tell it to the students.
Okay.
Sir.
Yeah.
I remember I had a teacher when I was in when I was studying in first standard, where she used to beat the students with the notebooks. If the notebook is incomplete or if there is any mistake, she used to beat with that notebook on students' head. So when you said about this, I was remembering, I could see that scenario in my eyes.
yes. Beating with the text notebook.
Yes, sir. On the head, right on the head.
On the head. Okay. Very good. I expected this type of experience through your comments. Very good. Then.
Punishing the student without reason.
Punishing the student without reason. Very good. Very good.
And there are certain teachers who used to shout while asking doubts. So if we have any doubts, we are scared to ask them the questions or the doubts, because we are scared if they will shout at us or how they're going to respond. So we just keep those doubts aside and learn what we just understood.
Excuse me, am I audible?
Yeah. Yeah, sure.
There are some teachers who ignoring the students always, even though if a student is saying the right answer. If the same student does not belong to a pet one, sometimes he may or she may avoid. Partiality. Such kind of experiences I had.
Partiality is there.
Yeah.
Excuse me.
Yeah.
Some teachers only think from their perspective. They don't try to understand the student perspective before coming to a judgment.
Yeah, teachers are thinking from their own perspective. Yeah.
Excuse me?
Yes.
Some teachers are prejudiced about these students, or their response and attitudes.
Yeah. Have you had any experience, sir?
Yes, I have.
Okay.
Pickano.
I expect 10 in number. Now it is reached in 8. Seven.
It's funny that I had a teacher who always come to the class and sleep in the class. And sleep in the afternoon hours. He'll sit in the chair he'll sleep. And once I remember that once I got, he was a Malayalam teacher, and I got 115 marks out of 100. How's that? He was so much interested in sleeping than teaching.
Okay.
Hello, sir.
Yes, tell me.
there are some teachers who won't admit their mistakes. I'm not saying that teachers are always wrong, but sometimes they happen to have some mistakes. If the students correct them, they won't accept that it was a mistake and they will stick to whatever that they have said. I had a teacher like that when I was in the high secondary.
Yeah, very good, very good. They are not ready to admit their mistakes.
Hello, sir. Am I audible?
Yeah.
Okay, sir. So I just have had an experience of humiliation that for example, if a homework is given and if you make a simple mistake and if you made a mistake that you're humiliated in front of others. So it's like you make a fool of others and you never even answer any questions when asked in the class.
Teasing or torturing, something like that.
Yeah, almost. Thank you, sir.
Sir, teaching the students without understand the students' level, basic level.
Yeah.
Sir?
Yes.
There are some teachers who are giving importance to those who are sitting in the front row.
Teachers?
There are some teachers who are giving importance to those who are sitting in the front row.
Sure. Only concentrating on front bench.
Yeah.
Hi, sir. There are certain teachers who judge students on the basis of their marks.
Yeah. Very good. Judge students on the basis.
Only on the basis of the mark, not on the basis of their personality or something like that.
Correct. Only based on the achievement, classroom achievement, or subject achievement, something like that.
Excuse me.
Yes, sir.
Some teachers talks to the blackboard or to the textbooks, not to the students.
Okay.
Some teachers are not sufficient knowledge in their subject matter. Yeah. Their lack of subject competency.
Subject competency.
Also, sir, there are certain teachers who just give importance to the answers in the answer sheet, which is exactly the cut copy paste of what is given in the textbook, and they are very much strict that it should, if the essay answer should be exactly 6 marks, 6 pages, and all the 6 pages answer should be exactly like how is it given in the textbook. So they are not actually promoting any kind of creativity or the own language of the students. It's only just how it is given in the textbook, but nothing how they will not appreciate if the child has written the same concept in their own language.
Yeah, if it is in a different way, that will not be appreciated. Okay, and within the short span of time, I have got 16 responses. You see 16 responses. So this is quite interesting. If you read or if you note all these things, see, communication gap between teacher and student. You know, this is the big problem. This is the most significant problem. I would say the most significant communicator of this universe is teacher, because teachers are always communicating to the living beings. Just we can compare other field of other area of work, you know, apart from the teachers. So some workers or some performers are communicating with the different areas of stakeholders, but you think teachers are entirely different. You are communicating to the real world and you are communicating to the future society. You are communicating to the state. You are communicating to the humanity. That is why the communication of teacher is very, very important. Here, the gap between teacher and student communication is the most significant aspect. Then, be it with the text. This is, I don't know how to explain and how to say. What is the behavior of the teacher? Leave it. Then ignoring the student. I'm not reading all the points. Ignoring the student. See, this is another area. Why that respected teacher mentioned these things? It is emotional. It is there in his or her affective domain, ignoring. Then teaching from their own perspective, teaching from teacher's own perspective, not considering the student. There the students are ignoring, or the students are not satisfied with the teacher's perspective. And also the anxiety of the student, unsatisfied there, prejudiced about the students, sleep in the classroom, just like beat with the text. Then not ready to admit the mistake. That is a drastic behavior. Then humiliation in front of others, that is very important. In front of others, they are teasing, they are torturing, they are humiliating for simple things. Then teaching without understanding the level of the student, that is also very important. Teach the students without understanding the level of the student, without knowing the student, they are teaching, they are doing their duty. Then concentrating only on front bench or left side or right side or girls only. Judge the students on the basis of marks. Mark, scoring the mark is only the criteria of the achievement. Then only blackboard and textbook. Lack of subject competency. Then the last one, bookish answer. Bookish answer is appreciated. No other out of box thinking like that. So now my job is very clear. What is art of teaching? So we have discussed about the attributes of most notorious teacher. Even though most notorious, he is a teacher. Most inefficient teacher, he is a teacher. He is considered as a teacher. Then can you say simply from this discussion, what is art of teaching? Based on this 16 point, now in this stage, what do you say about what is art of teaching? Is there any ready-made answer?
Knowing the minds of students and imparting knowledge.
Okay. Know the minds of the student.
Excuse me?
Yeah.
Art of teaching is creating knowledge in the class.
Creating knowledge in the class. Creating knowledge. Can you replace another word for create?
Implement. Implement, can we say like that?
Imparting. Imparting knowledge.
No, not imparting, not imparting.
Yeah. More better words for creating knowledge. Creating.
Let me think.
Generating ideas.
Sorry?
Generating ideas.
Constructing knowledge.
Okay.
You are constructing knowledge. Constructing
knowledge. That is the right word. That's what I'm expecting. Constructing the knowledge. So if you are constructing the knowledge in the classroom, it becomes art. Because all art forms are constructive and creative. So is any other answer on the perspective of these 16 points? I would say simply, if you are ready to analyze all these 16 plus points, I know there are many more points. All these 16 points, and if you purposefully avoid all these 16 points, and if you are ready to replace another aspects in order to make your classroom more and more powerful, more and more encouraging, there you become an artist. Just to think about these listed 16 points. Why can't you avoid all these attributes in the classroom? And also, you just think about, even though in a short span of time, while you are engaging in the classroom, maybe some silly aspects of or small aspects of these 16 points may be there in your own class also. Are you agree with me? Knowingly or unknowingly, some students may express their opinion regarding your class, that points may be congruent with these 16 points. That is my idea. So have you ever thought about your classroom? That is why I have already thought, already told you that that word meta thinking about your teaching process. How you are teaching? How the people are thinking about your classroom? How the people are assessing you? How the people are evaluating you as a teacher? So if you take the feedback of your student, you can simply see all these attributes there, maybe in your class. Have you ever think about that situation? So that is my topic, or that is my point to concentrate. That is, art of teaching is, if you think about this type of experience while you were there in your classroom and avoid all such nuisance in your classroom, definitely you will become a different teacher. That teacher, there, that teaching and that classroom become so close to my title, that is the art of teaching. That is my point. So I will share you these 16 points. That is very, very interesting points. Then coming to next discussion point, this one. If you avoid all these attributes and replace with right things, there you become an artist in teaching. So to become an artist, my next discussion area is, you have to link with life. Link your teaching with life. Better word, link education with life. So I will tell you some more points. What is life? Simply, see my slide. A day in your life. Think about a day in your life. Good morning, personal time, breakfast, then conveyance to the college or office, reached in office, college or school, etc. Then tea, lunch, tea, as usual routine. Then back to home, play time, free time, WhatsApp time, evening, then food and sleep, good night. So this is the daily activity in one sense. It is for the future discussion, you know. Then from good morning to good night, two major activities are there. When you are thinking from your meta thinking process with regard to teaching, I would say two major activities are there in this good morning to good night. From good morning to good night, two major activities. Can anybody guess what may be that two activities? Two major dominant activities. Remember, you are guessing from the perspective of a teacher. This is your day. From good morning to good night.
Talking and listening, sir.
Talking and listening. Talking and listening. Okay.
Learning and teaching.
Learning and teaching. Okay. Well, any other response? It's enough. I'm so happy. First response itself, the perfect response as far as I'm concerned. Because my answer is that is the answer, teaching and learning. Then the second response also, it is very close to that first response, talking and listening. So teaching and learning is somewhat academic, and talking and listening, it's a colloquial, something like that. And teaching like talking and learning like listening in one sense. So my answer is correct. Teaching and learning. This is my answer. So I'm so happy to get that answer. You see, from good morning to good night, two major activities are there. Whatever may be that we are involving in the day-to-day activities, there should be two activities should be take place. Sometime it will be a teaching, or otherwise it may be learning. Simply, you and we are all are teaching to somebody or learning something from anybody. That may be living or non-living things, whatever may be. You think about your sharp morning and the time up to you are spending up to the sleep time. Good night. That is why good morning and good night. Okay. Then, without breaking the connection, I am again linking my slide to another way. Teach, learning and teaching. See the next slide. Teaching and learning is equal to education. So when we are splitting up the word education, the major two components are one is teaching and learning. If it is so, see, education is life, because in your daily routine, two major activities are there, that is teaching and learning. So when we combine teaching, learning, it is education. That means your a day is teaching and learning. In other words, your day is education. So education is life. The day is the day activity or daily routine, that is your life. Yesterday's life, today's life, tomorrow's life. So it becomes education. That is why education is equal to life, or life is equal to education. If it is so, see, what is teaching? What is the art of teaching? It becomes life itself, because life is equal to education. Education is teaching and learning. In that sense, teaching and learning is equal to life. So you should link your teaching learning activities with life, or you should link your education with life. നമ്മുടെ മാതൃഭാഷയിൽ പറഞ്ഞാൽ ജീവിതഗന്ധിയായ വിദ്യാഭ്യാസം, ജീവിതഗന്ധിയായ വിദ്യാഭ്യാസം. സോ ഹൗ ഫാർ യു ഏബിൾ ടു ലിങ്ക് ദ എഡ്യൂക്കേഷൻ വിത്ത് ലൈഫ്, ദർ യു ബിക്കംസ് ദ ആർട്ടിസ്റ്റ്. ദർ പീപ്പിൾ എൻജോയ് യുവർ ക്ലാസ്സസ്. ദർ ക്ലാസ് റൂം ബിക്കംസ് എ തിയേറ്റർ ഓർ എ പെർഫോമിംഗ് അറീന, സംതിങ് ലൈക്ക് ദാറ്റ്. ദർ സ്റ്റുഡൻസ് ആർ എൻജോയിങ് യുവർ പ്രസന്റേഷൻ. Their students are enjoying your class. Their knowledge is generating. Their knowledge is constructive. So without linkage with life, it is not at all possible. That is why the simple definition for education, it is none other than education is life and life is education. Now, for discussion, I would like to show my next slide. This is very, very important. So as far as when we are discussing about the educational scenario, the dominant educational paradigm, teaching, I would say teaching is a didactic instruction. Teacher is there in the classroom, maybe in the platform or in the same level of the student, or in front of the podium, or in front of the smart board or something like that. Whatever may be, teacher is acting as the superior authority is there, and it is a didactic instruction. Students are there. Then learning, it is on sort of information transmission. Teacher is transmitting the information to the students. Then teacher, he consider as the treasury of knowledge. Learner know nothing. That is why he or she is sitting in our classroom, in front of our classroom, and we think that he know nothing, and we people are responsible to give everything to these students. Okay, this is my argument, you know. If you are you agree with my these four points argument? If no, if you are not agreeing, what about the ideal situation? Please respond.
Excuse me?
Yes.
Learner know nothing. That's, yes. I can't agree with that statement. Because learners come to our classes with many knowledge. Even into the LKG classes, the students come with a lot of knowledge.
So, sir, saying about the ideal situation, my argument is learner know nothing. But the ideal situation is, he says that learner know many things. Okay.
Yeah. And teacher may not be a treasury of knowledge. He may have the knowledge about his own subjects or his own areas.
Yeah, that's also I agree. Then
learning is information transmission. It's not a transmission, but we discussed before that it is constructing, and learners are constructing knowledge in their classrooms.
Yes, yeah, okay. Then teaching.
Teaching didactic means instructive, I think. It's almost, it may be true.
Yeah.
In present situation, it may be true. But actually, a teacher must be, he must be a mentor.
Yeah. Any other comments?
The first one, the teacher is not a superior. Nowadays, in the class, the teacher is not a superior. Only the students are.
Students are the superior or the central figure in the process of teaching learning. Okay.
Yes. Students are they are the main factor in the case of class.
Okay, I agree.
Because many difficulties in the case of teacher, they are facing different difficulties from students.
Okay. Anything more?
Sir, learning becomes effective when it is a give and take relationship.
Okay.
Then teaching, it is not merely instruction. It is active participation from both the students and the teachers.
Yes.
The four points in your paradigm, this is a bitter reality and that needs to be changed.
Okay.
We are against these four points.
Yeah.
Only then could we be artists.
Yeah. And you are totally against
these four. All the four points are outdated.
Okay.
In the present scenario.
I agree.
And you are requested to tell us something to improve upon this.
Sure.
I appreciate your presentation.
Thank you, sir.
Can I talk, sir?
Sure. Tell me.
Yeah, I kind of agree with the last speaker. He said that this is outdated. Actually, I think that we have come a long way from this. We have become counselors, from teachers to counselors to mentors, and we are kind of mentors now. So we are already past the stage, and if any teacher is still there, it's his or her lack of, you know, kind of adapting into the situation. Students won't take it in as it is when you say that you know nothing. You gotta admit that they know something about all these things. This is an information technology era. Everyone has access to unlimited information. But I have some dominance over some of the areas of the things that I'm teaching. See, I'm a teacher who is qualified here. So kind of I know something extra about it. So they admit that. And I also admit that they know something about it too. So it's kind of admitting that we all know, we all are, you know, according to your slide, we all are treasuries of knowledge. But this is kind of a professional setup. So in this setup, we kind of admit that teacher knows better than me so that the system may go smooth. And it's kind of, you know, kind of understanding the teacher, understanding the students, as someone else earlier said, this is a give and take policy. We give respect to the teacher as she knows better than us. And also as teacher, we give respect to the student that he also knows something. So kind of, you know, if everyone is in an agreement, the transmission of knowledge and feelings to go smooth. And if it is that beautiful, teaching is, you know, kind of artistic, as you said.
I'm sorry, I was not taken in proper spirit. I didn't mean any disrespect to teachers, but in the present scenario and post-COVID situation, we are becoming aware of shortcomings of traditional approach. And I believe those 4 points, they cater to the traditional things. And we are not, they show that we are not ready to change. Now this blended learning that is becoming popular, what is that? That shows us shortcomings of our traditional approach. It is not a question of disrespecting or respecting. This is academic discussion and we ought to be objective. That is what I feel.
Okay, okay. No, sir, this slide's actually for, I put forward this slide for a debate, you know. This is not an ideal slide. So now you go to, all of you, please go to the last two statements there. What about the ideal? You are all talking about the ideal thing. I have shown you that is this teaching didactic instruction. Maybe it is olden concept, traditional concept, as you said. No teachers are there in this way now. But still, in the research findings shows in the field of education, if you are taking the feedback of the students, all the teachers are talking about the ideal thing. What is the ideal? That is, in my slide, you can see learner know nothing. I know, sir, you are not agreeing with me. You are not, sir, agreeing with me. But
sir, can I comment on the fourth point, sir?
Yes, yes.
Yes, sir. Sir, here it has it is written, learner know nothing. So here the learner is not merely the student, sir. It can also be the teacher, because education is a continuous process from birth, from the cradle to the grave. So it is a continuous process. So here the learner is not merely the student. It can also be the teacher. Teacher can also learn a lot of things from the students.
Definitely, definitely. That is, I would say, teacher is those who are organizing the learning process. That is the modern teacher. Teacher, the ancient teacher is, he is transmitting the knowledge. The modern teacher is organizing the process. It is actually not teaching process or learning process. The activities, the process in the classroom, classroom process. The teacher organizes the classroom process. There, as you said, both teacher and learner becomes a learner. Learning process is taking place there. That is why in postmodern concept in education, there is a saying that there is no teaching but learning only. That is the conclusion. So my slide is, it is for only for discussion. Why this type of discussion taking place in this presentation? That is because of, I have listed all these things in this way. So after that, I would like to ask again, what about the ideal? When I am displaying these 4 points, you are all talking about the ideal situation. The ideal situation means the classic situation. There you are opposing me. Learner is know nothing. It is not correct, sir. Learner is know everything. That is the ideal thing. But again, after that, we can put a comma for that discussion. Then again, I am asking, what about the ground reality? Based on these discussions, your argument, my argument, you go to the real classroom. The real classroom of our higher education or general education. What about the ground reality? Can you say?
Your 4 points are reflection of ground reality.
Yeah. That is the answer what I am expecting from you. These 4 points are the reflection of ground reality. So always we are talking about the ideal things. How far these ideal things are implemented in our classroom? That is my topic, meta thinking about your teaching process. Can you say?
Very, very true.
Yeah.
Excuse me.
Yeah.
Can I? So it was a wonderful session. From the beginning onwards, I was eagerly listening. And I have passed through the most of the points. And I believe that one of the point was very striking, and that was the meta thinking, as one of the faculty now telling you about that. See, sir, I think that is the only one solution and a suggestion that you have given us. A meta thinking can improve our teaching, definitely. Thank you for that information. Thank you.
I would like to ask some more comments regarding what about the ground reality. So, being a research scholar, in that way, I would say, research scholar or research guide or a student in the field of education, I am always getting different types of feedbacks from the students. At the basis of that feedbacks and studies, that is my question is there, what about the ground reality? Ground reality, these four points are the, as you said, sir said, it is the reflection of ground reality. But in order to overcome that reality, that ground reality, not merely saying the ideal or listing the ideal is not the solution. So we should stand in the solution part. That is my proposal, that is meta thinking. You think about your teaching process. Again, I would say. So we can list out all these things. We can propose these points. We can comment these type of comments in the sessions, but it is not the solution. Again, if I am evaluating your class to straight away, I would like to say, if I draft a feedback questionnaire to your students in your classroom, what they will say? Just you think about it. I'm not blaming the teachers. I respect teachers. I have immense faith in the potential of teachers. Once you have appointed as a teacher in an institution, you are the respected fellow, no problem. No, I'm not compromising in all this. We are all teachers. But you think about the ground reality. The ground reality is pathetic. It is entirely different. That means we are all teaching all these things. We are all telling all these things. We are all arguing all these things. Well, but when we are all the reality in the classroom, when you are standing or we are facing the students in the classroom, how far it is possible?
May I come in?
Yes, sir.
The important word from your discussion was postmodern.
Yes.
The reality has to do with postmodernity. And it has affected every field of life.
Yeah.
If the teacher is not aware of these paradigm changes, then he will be an odd creature in the modern world.
You are correct. You are, that is very important. That is very important. In olden days, the teacher and the modern teacher, it is entirely different. Because in olden days, in ancient days, in one sense, we can say students are not much evaluating the teacher. In those days, knowledge is not at all exploded. Knowledge explosion is not at all as like in this modern era. That is why students are, you just think about the Gurukula system. There, guru is everything.
Yeah.
The disciple is there in front of the guru, submitting everything.
Yeah.
Yeah. What about this nowadays? Where that guru, where that student? You already told me that sometime the student may be the guru here.
Correct.
So that change should be reflected in our profession. But unfortunately, most of the teachers are there in this olden age. That is why, what about the ground reality? This is an interesting discussion. So thank you for your valuable comments. Then let me go to the next slide. This is a simple one. Areas of life. That is my new term, not education. It is life. That means areas of teaching and learning. So meaning of teaching, olden concept, information, instruction. So modern concept, education is life. The aims of teaching and learning, it was knowledge acquisition, but man and society making. That is the shift. Then curriculum, subject-centered, now learner-centered. Method, cramming system, that is learning by heart. Now it is experienced learning. That is very important. Experienced learning. Experiential learning. If you are ready to provide experience to the student, then discipline, repressive, and self-discipline. Here, examination, memory-based. It is process-oriented and objective-based. Process is more important than the product. Project report is not at all important, but how the students are going through the project process, how you done it, that is very important. That report is immaterial. Anybody can produce a report from a DTP center. That is not at all important. It is process oriented. That is, process is more important than the product. Then agency is school. As you said, now the sole agency is not alone school, but society as a whole. Both teacher and students are studying everything from the society. And he is studying something for the society. Their teaching and learning becomes life, life-oriented. Then teacher, sole authority of all, but here friend, philosopher, and guide. It's a familiar term. Or better to say, he's a facilitator. He's a mentor. He's a counselor. He's a friend. Then student, he was or she was passive listener. Now he is the active participant. Active participant. He is responsible for his learning. That is the modern concept. Students are responsible for their learning. So we should have the capability or potential to assign that responsibility upon the student while you are engaging in your classroom. Then school, place of distributing knowledge yesterday. Today, it is the miniature of the society. That is what is going on in SAFI now, you know. It is not merely teaching or learning. You are bringing the society into the campus. And also, you are taking your campus to the society. That is the concept of real education. But yesterday, it was only a place of distributing the knowledge. Today, we can't go through that concept. That is why we are taking SAFI to the society. All the institutions in such a way. So through this orientation session, what you are doing, actually you are taking your institution to the whole world, and the whole world is looking or coming to these SAFI. That is why our education institutions are miniature of the society. This is just to remind all these things, you know, they are not new things. Still, why teaching often fails? That is the next discussion point. On the basis of the earlier slide, this one. So I would say you are all in the passionate to this modern concept. You are considering education as life, and you are considering your institution as a miniature of society. You are actively participating your students, and you become friend and philosopher. The society as a whole, that is your institution. And you are implementing a process-oriented teaching there. Repressive type of discipline, no beating upon the head through with his textbook or something like that. And you are providing experience to the student. Learner is the nucleus of your institution. Students are the nucleus of the, or the center of your institution. And you are totally conducting a man-making process there in your institution. Still, why teaching often fails? That's a question to you. But within the time frame, I would like to show you two more slides for the speedy discussion. Why teaching often fails? See, teaching often fails because students fail to become engaged with the material. This is only some points, you know. Second one, memorize materials often without meaning or understanding. why this is the responsibility vested upon the teacher, you know. Why students are memorizing materials often without meaning or understanding, as you told in the beginning, it is the, here the victims are the students, but the problem with the teacher. And do not remember material they learned earlier. Here also, teacher becomes the villain. Cannot apply the concept to solve the problem. So these are all the some points for the failing of this activity, teaching. Then come to the part of solution. So this is a reality, still this is a reality. Even though we are all discussing about these modern things, postmodern aspect of education, both teaching and learning, still teaching often fails. That is, again, we are reaching to that point, construction of knowledge. Actually, what do you mean by construction of knowledge? Understanding the learning are understanding and learning are active, constructive, generative process, such as assimilation, argumentation, and self-reorganization. Then teachers' words don't simply become directly engraved in the student's mind after passing through the ear. These words should be interrupted by the student by variety of engagements. There is no teaching but learning only. Again, I repeat, there is no teaching but learning only. Teaching is the process of organizing learning. Teacher, those who organize learning. So let me conclude these slides for open discussion. That is there. If you provide such type of an experience in your classroom, where there is no teaching but learning only. As teacher said already, just before madam says, both teachers and students are learning. There is no teaching but learning only. Teaching is the process of organizing learning. There, you know, counselor is there, mentor is there, friend is there, philosopher is there, teacher, those who organize learning. Then tell me, can you identify the artist here? Then what about your reality? So it's a time for common, that is, I think, three or four minutes, I continuously spoke. That is not desirable in such type of an interactive session. Tell me, what do you say about these previous slides? What's your experience?
Hello.
Yes.
Am I audible?
Sure, sir.
Friend, philosopher, and guide.
Yeah.
This equation needs to be considered.
Sure.
If I analyze these three phrases, if the teacher agrees to be friend, philosopher, and guide, I think that could be one of the solutions.
Solution. To become an artist in the classroom.
Yeah.
Okay. Welcome, sir.
So may I add something?
Yeah.
I feel that, you know, the teaching learning process is going through a lot of transformation. And yes, as you said, this is the ideal situation. And in fact, though there may be teachers who practice this ideal, you know, classroom situation and classroom setup, but yet I think one of the failures of this system is because of our assessment system and our examination system, which doesn't, you know, gorge a student's learning capabilities from, you know, the ideal classroom situation, but rather a rote learning process, which is one of the reasons for the failure of the teacher in becoming an artist, and for some of us, in fact, to again, you know, move back to the traditional approach again. So that's just an observation, a very practical one, sir.
Yeah. That is very significant observation, I think. Anything more to add?
Sir.
Yeah.
Sir, actually an artist is someone who is creating things differently.
Yeah.
Yes. So if the teacher is able to create or if the teacher is able to make a student think that he is capable of doing a lot of things, then we can say that teacher is an artist.
Sure.
Hello, sir. May I add something?
Welcome, sir.
Hello.
Welcome, sir. We are all here.
So if we think that teacher is an artist, then teaching is an art, and art always looks as beautiful. So that beautification will come only when, if teacher comes with him or her with such resources that help him to beautify that teaching as an activity. Thank you.
Sir, if the student is able to come out in different colors, if the teacher is able to bring out the different colors in a student, then we can say that, yes, of course, teacher is an artist.
Yeah, that is a reflective answer. So always artist creates different variety of things. Artist, the product of art or artist, the final product of an artist is wonderful, beautiful. In such a way, if you produce such type of a student having different,
yes sir,
real artist, that is the real artist.
Yeah, all the teachers have got different colors in their hands, but how a teacher successively use the colors to give shape to a new person.
Sure.
Thank you, sir.
If teacher is creating an art, then student is appreciator. That both are equally involved in the process. So the beauty of teaching and learning will be felt only when that kind of environment is created and both are actively involved, actively engaged.
Definitely. Please go. Okay. The
Hello,
prime
sir.
Of
just a minute.
Yes, sir.
I want to speak something.
Yeah.
Your this lecture of yours is itself an ideal piece of art. The way you led us into the argument, that was not traditional.
That was
the mode that you chose. Now it was a challenging thing, but you successfully struck home.
Yeah.
So that itself is an example of teaching as an art.
Yes. Most welcome, sir. So what I would say, that is, you think about that finished product. When teacher becomes an artist, as you said, as madam said, best colorful or best output is there in the form of students. You think about these best students are the treasures of society. Because tomorrow's society that you are creating through these best students. In that sense, being an artist, you are doing most responsible job.
So that is why it is said that teachers are social engineers.
Yeah. Again, these are all ideal things. When we are talking about two more ideal things, especially teachers, I always think about the practical side and ground reality. That is why I am coining that word ideal. Then you see the last part of my session. That is, there is no teaching but learning only. Teaching is the process of organizing learning. Teacher those who organize learning. Then coming to know yourself as a teacher. You have to say a number of things. Know yourself as a teacher. Then, in my opinion, there are four types of teachers. One is memory level teachers. Second one is understanding level teachers. Third one is application level teachers. And the fourth one is reflective level teachers. So let me stop my badai in local language, then start your comments. What do you know? What do you understand about? What is your perspective about this memory level teacher, understanding level teacher, application level teacher, reflective level teacher? Just think about a span of a second, something like that. Then please respond. One more condition. After thinking about these four levels, if you reveal in which level at present you are in your classroom, if you reveal that your level, it should be highly appreciated. Start your comments. Or think about all these four levels and place you yourself in a particular level and start your comments with, sir, I am now in the application level because I am doing all the things in such a way. You can explain your position in that way. Let us start.
Actually, I could be using these levels as need arises.
Sorry?
As is needed.
Yeah.
This proposition is need based.
Okay.
You cannot fix yourself at one particular level.
Level, okay.
The level will depend upon the challenge and the calling. So I need to change. Maybe I get a mix of all these four things.
Okay. In different situations, you are acting in different levels.
Yes.
Okay.
So can I say a word?
Yeah.
So reflective level, I just want to comment one or two sentences about that. So when I was in college days, teachers used to say that God is love. Yes. So at that time, I can only understand the peripheral meaning of it. Yes, God is love. Yes, but in my later, in my through my experiences, later when I'm hearing that same sentence, now I can understand what is the real meaning of God is love. That can be reflective level. Later in your experience, when you are just going through what you have earlier learned, later, if you are giving extra meaning to all these things, that is going to be reflection. Thank you, sir.
Absolutely right. Then I want to know, being a teacher, as a teacher, considering this meta thinking about your teaching process, are you a memory level teacher, understanding level teacher, application level teacher, or reflective level teacher?
I'm all these four.
Yeah?
I'm a mix of all these four.
Mix of all these levels. Okay.
So we cannot say that I am like this, I am like that. Because the person's mood varies. The person itself is changing day by day. So we cannot say that, yes, in this time, sometimes I will be in the memory level. Yes, I will be thinking about all the past. Sometimes I will be in the understanding level when I am talking to my children. I will be at the understanding level. And when I am doing certain things, yes, whenever I am teaching my students, I will be at the application level. And later, when I am thinking about my parents, yes, sir, when I have to communicate with my parents, then I will think that tomorrow also I will be in the same stage. So reflection.
Excuse me.
Sir, may I add something?
Sure.
Sir, may I add something? You've talked about these four different levels. Very interesting. I teach literature. So, the memory level doesn't work much for us. We usually a lot of instilling of that. But of course, the other four levels make a point and do help our students. and when we adopt these levels. But apart from this, I think as a literature student, as teacher, I do adopt another level, which I don't know whether you can include it here or you can think about it, because I adopt another level, which I call a I'm calling it the creative level, because we teach our students to differ with whatever is being said. Because in literature, we do not have, it's not always what I say is always correct. We encourage different kinds of thinkings, and so I think another level. That's just my point, sir.
Sure.
May I add something?
Sure.
Yeah, sir. Actually, it depends. As my teacher, Dr. M. S. Sheikh, Honorable Dr. M. S. Sheikh, has reflected upon, and he said that all the four kinds of methods or techniques that I will use. So this is, I agree with and I go with that statement, because the teacher is giving treatment to the content as well as treatment to the students. So it depends that in a situation, what kind of scene appears, what kind of content is there, what kind of teachers, students' moods are there. So accordingly, teacher changes and accordingly takes into account the levels. Thank you, sir.
Sir, regarding the memory level, I always used to think that I used to cram my head for remembering a particular phone number.
Any other comments? All the responses are quite interesting, imaginative, and what I would say, it is reflective. It's really reflective. And one interesting statement that is, sir, can you add one more level with the creative level? Ma'am, actually, when you are reflecting, if you are creative, then only you can reflect. In that sense, creative are always reflecting. Creative people are always reflecting. You think about our former president, APJ Abdul Kalam. So his quotations are very popular and very famous. Why? Always we are speaking or stating something in a formal way, but APJ Abdul Kalam making the same area or content in a different way. That is, I would say, it is a reflective level. Why it is reflective level? Because he is not only a president or a scientist, but a most creative personality. So that is why my reflection and ma'am, your creative is somewhat same. And think about the level of teachers. All your comments are very, very thoughtful. And you see, when you are teaching something in your classroom, maybe we start with memory level. Then slowly go to understanding level. Then again, application level. And the most creative level is reflective level. But why I am showing this slide, or why I am putting forward these points to discussion, is that it is very simple. In the process of meta thinking about teaching, you should know all these levels. Then only you can make wonders in the classroom. If you are explaining a particular point, sometime you can easily start from the understanding level. That is, you are already told, without knowing the level of the students, you are resuming your topic from day two. There you can start your explanation or description from application level. Whatever may be your level, the final goal of your teaching learning should be to enable the student to reflect upon the content area. That is my conclusion. To enable the student to reflect upon your content area. You are teaching economics. You are teaching geography. You are teaching zoology. When you are teaching economics, so many things are there. So many things to memorize. So many things to understand. So many things to apply in the life, but the students must be or should be able to reflect upon the economic situation of the state, the economic situation of his or her family, the economic situation of in his individual life. So you are studying, you are teaching environmental science. What should be the reflective level regarding that subject? If you are teaching literature, what should be the reflection? If you are teaching mathematics, what should be the reflection? So always looking upon the reflective level. So that is why this is a broad area, and now it is 6:35, you know. So I would like to give you these 4 points for better meta thinking in your teaching learning process. When you reach in the reflective level, and as a teacher, you may not reach in the reflective level, but if you reach the student, if you lead the student up to application level, no doubt he will reflect. But unfortunately, most of the teachers are starting with the memory level and deepening to understanding level. They think that is the final goal. Oh, have you understood? Okay. But apply the same. That is very important. Then only student can reflect. This reflection is very, very, very crucial in the teaching process. So if you are always sticking upon the reflective level, there I would repeat the same thing, that classroom, that is the art of teaching. Because reflection, creativity, and art, all these terms are closely associated. Then let me conclude that area there. Then one or two slides more. Plan your task. So within the time constraints, I would like to conclude my session. This is the last one. Plan your task to become an artist in your teaching. That is three phases of real teaching: pre-active phase, interactive phase, and post-active phase. This is very simple. Pre-active phase means, before starting this session for you in this SAFI teacher enrichment program, when I got the invitation to interact with you, from that moment itself up to the moment start of this class, that is my pre-active phase. Then sharp 5 p.m. we have started from 5 p.m. to 6:40. That is the interactive phase of this session. And the post-active phase of this session starts from whenever I am completing this session. Maybe it is from 6:45 to 2. That 2 is very important. 6:45 to up to the next beginning of next session. I don't know. Wherever maybe that session is taking place. In which subject, which area. Whatever may be. That is my post-active session. This is, you know, this is a cyclic process. We are preparing and we are presenting, getting the feedback, refining. There again, we are planning and presenting the same in this way. So my pre-active for this session may be the result of the last session's post-active. I would like to add that to that meta-thinking process of teaching these three phases, no time to explain. Then again, context and interface for these three levels. If you don't plan, the student will plan for you. This is a warning from my part. No need of much explanation, because whenever we were a student in the past, think about our teachers, that notorious teachers, without planning much, he or she came to our class. At that time, we planned for him. Have you remembered that planning? It is quite interesting. So if you don't plan, the student will plan for you, no doubt. And also, two things are which is closely connected to this aspect. One is discipline and another one is management. Discipline is the reaction to misbehavior after it has occurred, while management is action that prevents misbehavior from occurring. You just replace these two concepts into your classroom. Why teaching often fails? Because the reaction to misbehavior after it has occurred. Why that reaction or by that misbehavior? Students are tend to misbehave because the answer is very simple. Students definitely misbehave. The answer is they are students. They are not teachers. So action that prevent misbehavior from the occurring, there, if you are acting as an artist, if your class, if your teaching becomes art, that action prevent misbehavior in the classroom. There, your planning is very good. Then another thing is, one of the deepest desire of human being is the desire to be appreciated. No need of explanation. That statement itself self-explanatory. That is why form teams, not groups, to appreciate teams. Innovation now emerges from team and networks. Group is common, but teamwork is rare. And in your meta-thinking process, try to add these points also. And the last four points, fourth thing I will do differently this academic year. This is the outcome, or this is the suggestions with regard to this session, and not only to this session. After completing this faculty development program, it is nicely organized by SAF Institute. You should take a decision. I will do four different things this academic year. One, number one, take the paperless challenge. No need of explanation. You have to comment after these 4 points. Take paperless challenge, because especially in this pandemic situation, this is inevitable. That is why you can call it as online or digital or something, whatever may be the terminology. Take the paperless challenge. Why it is challenge? It is a challenge for the teachers. You have to plan, you have to prepare, you have to think and think. You have to study new methodology. You have to adopt changes. You should have the ability to face the challenges. Then only it is possible. Take the paperless challenge. Number two, utilize formative assessment. Formative assessment means assessment and evaluation taking place throughout the learning process. It is not the summative. It is not the terminal assessment, but formative assessment, assessment and evaluation in between the teaching learning process is more and more important. Then again, three, flip my classroom. Flipped classroom, you might have got the idea regarding flipped classroom from Joshit class. I happen to see in session of Joshit regarding digital technology. Flipped classroom, I'm not explaining. That means you have to flip your classroom. Then the last one, four, create more opportunities for student interaction. These are the four challenges you have to make. And also I would like to comment one more thing, that is our examination system. Just I forgotten, one madam pointed out that examination system still in a traditional way. Why, how can we adopt all these things in a modern way? That is a very significant question. My answer is a simple answer. You do not give much stress or strain on the existing examination system. Because if you are exposing yourself, if you are providing these type of opportunities, or if you are ready to enhance the potential of the students, automatically they will survive. Forget about that examination system. They have the potential to face that challenge, whether it is modern examination system or ancient system. No, not bother about it. So you have to stick upon this artistic way of teaching. And I would like to conclude this session saying that teaching, I consider teaching is an art. Being a teacher educator, concentrating on pedagogic aspects, we always say that teaching is a classic scientific process, because there is definite methodology and notations for teaching. If you are doing this way, you will get this outcome. In that way, the process, everything is clear. In that sense, teaching is science. But remember, you are dealing with the living organism. In that way, these living organisms are different. They are versatile in all ways. That is why teaching is classic and science, but it is more art than science. So thank you for your patient listening and active interaction. Once again, I would like to express heartfelt gratitude to my respected beloved manager, Imbiji sir, and also the faculty, vibrant IQSC team of SAFI Institute, and those who are listening to me. Thank you. Thank you very much.